thank you so much that under the power of the latter rain that many, many will see their errors and will return and come to the truth of your word. We thank you for these great truths. We pray for the Holy Spirit, Lord, to guide us as we study today and nerve our hearts and our minds, Lord, to stand for these great truths, though the heavens fall. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, this afternoon we're going to look in the third angel's message that's found in Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 through 11. After we look at this message, then we'll have a Q&A. Now, what will happen after that, Lenore? We'll have a Q&A after this meeting, and then
have a break until 6.
A break until 6 o'clock. And then we'll come back for our final meeting, which will be communion and an ordination service. Okay. All right. So the third angel's message, Revelation 14, 9 through 11. The Bible says the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. He shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. The smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest day or night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." Now, isn't that interesting? In Revelation 14, verse 9, in the third angel's message, we have a word that is also mentioned in the first angel's message that we looked at in Sabbath school this morning. What is the word that is used in this verse that was also found in Revelation 14 and verse 7? You remember what it was?
Worship,
Jack, that's exactly right. And in Revelation 14 and verse 7, it was talking about true worship, or honoring the commandments of God, and especially the one that pointed to Him as our Creator. But Revelation 14 and verse 9 warns against the worship of the beast and his image. Now, obviously here we have false worship. So at the end of time, a beast power and his image, these two powers in rebellion against the authority of God, will seek to set up a tradition that is the exact opposite of the fourth commandment and the true worship of God. And this beast and his image will set up a man-made tradition that is exactly the opposite of what Revelation 14:7 told us to do. And that was to honor the commandment that pointed to the Creator. We noticed in Matthew 15, verse 2 and verse 9, here is the entire statement in Matthew 15, 2 to 9. The Pharisees came to Christ and said, "Why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? They wash not their hands when they eat bread." Jesus said, "Why do you also transgress the commandment of God by your tradition? For God commanded, saying, honor thy father and mother, and he that curseth father or mother, let him die the death. But you say, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it's a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. So God had said, you must honor your parents. You must honor those in authority, as long as they don't tell you to disobey the words and commands of God. But the Jews had set up a tradition called Corban for a wealthy young person. If they had a lot of money, all they had to say to their parents was, oh, it's a gift. And therefore, the priests would become enriched with that money, and the people, the young people, no longer had to show honor to their parents. So Jesus said, you have made the commandment of God to honor your parents of none effect by your tradition. So the Jews set up something that was exactly contrary to the commandment of God. Jesus said, you hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh to me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And then Jesus laid it bare and said, in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. So folk, in Revelation 14, the great issue at the end of time is over the commandment of God that points to our Creator versus a commandment of men that has been set up by the beast in his image. And there will be the great issue at the end of time. True worship, honoring God's commandments through faith in Jesus Christ. False worship, honoring a man-made tradition that is in open rebellion against God's commandments. You know, sometimes as Seventh-day Adventists, we feel that because we are honoring one commandment of God's in keeping the seventh-day Sabbath, that we've got our meal ticket to the kingdom. But folk, if the Sabbath becomes our weekly confessional, if the Sabbath becomes everything in our religion, and we choose to live a life of rebellion against the authority of God's law throughout the week, the Sabbath has become meaningless. Because the Sabbath is a sign that we are in submission to God's authority through faith in Jesus Christ. So here is the contrast. Revelation 14:7, Revelation 14:9. Here, worship him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. Honor the commandment that reveals the Creator. And over here, if any man honors the tradition of the beast in his image, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. You know, folk, this is the great issue right here. This is the great issue that will divide humanity into two camps at the end of time. Now, I know today there are some folk that see all kinds of issues to be the great issue at the end of time. I've had people tell me that the issue of the Godhead is going to be the great issue at the end of time. I've had people say, well, I had somebody gave me a book, a dear lady gave me a book. It was called The Sacred Name. And it was about the name Yahweh. And in the book, the man came in his book to about page 56, and he said, the great issue at the end of time will be over the name we use to refer to deity, whether we call God Yahweh or we call him something else. Folk, The name of God is not the final issue for mankind. The Godhead is not the final issue for mankind. And so many other things that people make into issues today, this is the issue. This will be the focal point of the entire world. All the world's attention will be brought to bear on this slide right here. Right here. And anything else that becomes our focal point is a deception, a distraction, and taking us away from what God wants us to be focused on. This is the issue, friend, right here. Of course, the commandment that reveals God as our Creator is the seventh-day Sabbath from Exodus 20 and verse 11. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. So this over here, we are called upon to honor the commandment that reveals God as the Creator. Well, the exact opposite of that, a man-made tradition set up by the beast in his image, and it's false worship, it's the exact opposite of the Sabbath. Friends, it becomes so blatantly obvious what this is. This obviously is Sunday keeping. Right here. You know, I remember several years ago out at some meetings in Oregon, there was a Catholic priest who came to the meetings with his entourage. And during the meeting, folk, we looked at this very slide, this very content, and I pointed out, either we're honoring the Creator by resting on His day, or we are honoring the beast and his image who have set up Sunday worship. And one of the people that came with the priest to the meetings turned to him and said, and people around them heard what she said. She said, "Hughes doesn't know what he's talking about. He's a nut." And the Catholic priest, friends, the Catholic priest turned to the woman and said, "Don't be so sure about that." Folk, it doesn't take a PhD. It doesn't take a theologian. It doesn't take a doctor of theology. It doesn't take a scholar. Friends, this is so simple. This is so simple. So simple and so clear. So clear. Honoring the commandment that reveals the Creator, the seventh-day Sabbath. Now, friends, this issue is so paramount. It is repeated over and over again in Scripture. We found it in Revelation 14. Notice in the first plague in Revelation 16, 1 and 2. It says, "Go your way, pour out the vials of the wrath of God upon the earth." The first went and poured out his vial upon the earth. There fell a noisome and grievous sore upon the men which had the mark of the beast and upon them which worshipped his image. So nothing good, friends, is going to come for those that are worshiping in rebellion against the Creator of the universe. The first plague will fall upon those who are honoring the Sunday mark of the beast and his image. Revelation 19, 20 and 21 says, "The beast was taken, and with him the false prophet." Now it's going to become clear as we study that the false prophet and the image of the beast are the same power. that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that had worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. Again, friends, rebellion, no matter how you want to call it, rebellion leads to the first plague. Rebellion leads to the lake of fire. That's where rebellion's going. And 95%+ in this world today, and 95%+ of those who claim to be Seventh-day Adventists will end up getting the first plague. And they will also end up in the lake of fire. It's that simple. Because God is arbitrary? No. It's because we don't want to say, Lord, save me from myself. We don't want to admit what we're like. We want to think we're somehow good, and that by God letting us into heaven, that it's going to help heaven because of what we can offer it. How ridiculous is that? Revelation 20, verses 4 and 5. I saw thrones, and they sat upon them. Judgment was given unto them, and I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads, or in their hands, and they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. Folk, are we going to backpedal with our forefathers, with Leroy Froom and Roy Allen Anderson, when they wrote Questions on Doctrine in the 1950s? They backtracked, friends. They said, oh no, Sabbath and Sunday will not be the great issue at the end of time. Sunday keepers at the close of time will make it into heaven. No, they won't, friend. Rebellion's not going into the kingdom. Get real. It says here, those who stood against the rebellion of the beast and his image will live and reign with Christ 1,000 years. Now, who is this beast? There's a beast power, the Bible says, that sets up this Sunday tradition. And there's an image that's just a look-alike of the beast. So who is this beast? Well, let's take a look. Revelation 13 tells us about this beast. It's the first beast in Revelation 13. It's found in verses 1 through 10. Number 1, we find in Revelation 13 and verse 1, it's a political and also religious power. So it's both. Revelation 13:1 says it rises out of the sea. Well, it rises where there have always been existing kingdoms, which is in the Mediterranean world, over in the Mediterranean world. Verse 1 also says that it commits blasphemy. Blasphemy is claiming to be God on earth. That's what John 10:30-33 says. And he claims power to forgive sins. Mark 2, 5-7 says that. Now, friend, again, I don't need to go to religious school. I don't need to have letters after my name. All I have to do is simply be a child and say, Lord, you're my God, and I'm your child, and I'm going to accept whatever you say. Now, through these first characteristics right here, through these three, it's obvious who this power is. It can only be one power. It can only be the system of Roman Catholicism. They alone claim to be God on earth. They claim power to forgive sins. They rose in the Mediterranean world, and they are a political and religious power. They teach the immortal soul. They demand reverence because it thinks it is God. It forces people to worship the way it thinks, Revelation 13, 3 and 4. It gets its power from the devil, Revelation 13 and verse 2. It ruled the world for 1,260 years, Revelation 13, verse 5. It sought to usurp Christ's work on man's behalf in the heavenly sanctuary, Revelation 13, verse 6. It kills people in the name of God, Revelation 13, 7. And those who reject the authority of the papal power have their name written in the Lamb's Book of Life, Revelation 13 and verse 8. Now, folk, why is it, why don't we hear this message anymore? Why don't we hear about the beast and his image and his mark? Why don't we hear about that? You know why? Because it's not politically correct. Because today, folk, in our world, there's a consequence for pointing out the beast and his image. They don't want you to point out who they are. But friends, God will have people on this earth who will expose the beast of Revelation 13 and 14. You know, friends, here's three more characteristics. It received a deadly wound in 1798, Revelation 13, 3. It unites with America to enforce false worship, Revelation 13, 12. Its number is 666. Vicarius Filii Dei. Well, obviously, it's the Roman papal system. Right here in Vatican City. You know, it's amazing to me that Ted Wilson, in the 6 years that he has been the president of the General Conference, repeatedly tells us that we are to preach the three angels' messages to the world. You know what, friend? Not one time has Ted Wilson ever pointed out the third angel's message and who it represents. Somehow he becomes tongue-tied, as do many Seventh-day Adventist scholars. But no doubt about it, friend, this is the power of Revelation 14 and verse 9 through 11 that seeks to set up a false tradition of Sunday worship and enforce it on this planet called Earth. You say, well, Bill, the world's changing. That could never happen. There's other issues today that are more important. Well, friend, if you believe that, you'll suffer the first plague. If you believe that, you'll end up in the lake of fire. It's that simple. It's that simple. You know what, friend? 1 week from today, this is July the 9th, July the 16th, in Washington, D.C., there are going to be over 1 million evangelicals who are coming to Washington, D.C. to watch by satellite television Pope Francis talk to them about unity in Jesus. Now, friend, that is going to happen 1 week from today. So the papal power is striving to unite all of Christendom together, pseudo-Christendom, in unity in Jesus, which in essence is Sunday worship. So friend, it's happening. It's happening fast. This system is setting up a false religious plan to assist people to save themselves in their sins. Folk, I guarantee you, if we are choosing a path of sin today, if we are excusing sin in our lives today, one day we will embrace sun worship. One day we will. Because the entire papal system is designed to save two classes of people. Those who are trying to save themselves by their works, and those who are trying to save themselves in their sins. That's what the papal system is set up to do. Bible says to go along with their plan will bring the drinking of the wine of the wrath of God. The Bible is so clear, friends. So clear. What is the papacy's worship style? What is their plan? Well, they make it so clear. Thomas N. Wright from Redemptorist College, February 18, 1884. Prove to me from the Bible alone I am bound to keep Sunday holy. There is no such law in the Bible. It's a law of the Holy Catholic Church alone. The Bible says remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. The Catholic Church says no. By my divine power, I abolish the Sabbath day and command you to keep holy the first day of the week. The entire civilized world bows down in reverent obedience to the commandment of the Holy Catholic Church. The observance of Sunday by Protestants is an homage they pay in spite of themselves to the authority of the Catholic Church. Folk, I'm going to tell you, in the radio programs that we have currently going on in Africa, there are thousands of Catholics and evangelicals that are embracing the truth of the fourth commandment and are embracing Christ as their Savior, because the truth is so clear. It's so plain. So plain. To see. If Protestants would follow the Bible, they would worship God on the Sabbath day. In keeping Sunday, they are following a law of the Catholic Church. The state in passing laws for the due sanctification of Sunday is unwittingly acknowledging the authority of the Catholic Church and carrying out more or less faithfully its prescriptions. The Sunday is a day of the week set apart for the obligatory public worship of Almighty God, to be sanctified by a suspension of all servile labor, trade, and worldly avocations, and by exercises of devotion, is purely a creation of the Catholic Church. Couldn't be any plainer than that, could it? Couldn't be any plainer than that. And this is the message, part of the message of the third angel, to warn the world against honoring the Sunday tradition of the papal power. And so what do we do as Seventh-day Adventists, as the world is screaming to hear the three angels' messages? What are we doing as a people? We're getting involved in all kinds of things. all kinds of things. Yahweh and feast days and the Godhead and Sunday or Wednesday crucifixion, and God doesn't kill, and the church is Babylon, and time prophecy is now literal instead of symbolic. 25:20. All kinds of distractions, friend. When the Lord wants us to share with the world the three angels' messages, the exaltation of Christ, the warning against honoring the papal system that is a system of works righteousness. Years ago, the papal power with John Paul II came out with an encyclical called Dies Domini on keeping the Lord's Day holy. Should have awakened us as Seventh-day Adventists to the work God wants us to do. But no, we continue to get steeped deeper and deeper and deeper into distraction. How pathetic. John Paul quotes all the Bible verses that talk about the Sabbath. John Paul refers to them as Sunday. Revelation 1:10, when John said, "I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day," John Paul says, "That's Sunday." Shame on him. Shame on him. The man who authored it was the former Pope Benedict XVI. He's the one who wrote Dies Domini. And Francis, Pope Francis, came out with some encyclicals over the last year in which Pope Francis said that the answer to the ills of the world today is Sunday keeping. That's what he said was the answer, friend. That's what he said. As the head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, known as the Holy Office of the Inquisition, Ratzinger wrote the encyclical about Dies Domini, and anybody who disagreed with it was to suffer his wrath. Suffer his wrath. Pope Benedict has pushed for Sunday. He pushed for it. Francis has pushed for Sunday. Folk, I feel like the Lord is screaming at us. Screaming at us to get our focus right on the three angels' messages and sharing them with the world. Sharing them with the world. Benedict said, "Give the soul its Sunday. Give Sunday its soul," he said. Benedict said that Sunday is the day of the dawning of creation. How pathetic. And how about the image? Because the Bible says, "If any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God." So there's an image, Revelation 14:9 tells us, that's also referred to back for the first time in Revelation 13 and verse 14. There's an image that was set up in America. Let's read those verses. Revelation 13 and verse 11, we have the setting up of a lamb-like power that rises in a part of the world where there are few inhabitants. It comes up out of the earth. Revelation 13, 11 tells us that. Verse 14 says that this power, which is the United States of America, Verse 14, deceives them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound by a sword and did live. So friend, in the United States of America is the development of a religious group of people that will be a splitting image of the papal power. And what did the papal power do through the Dark Ages? Well, they, number one, they used the state to enforce their doctrines. And number two, as Lenore just said, for those that didn't go along, they used persecution to persecute those who would not go along with them. So, there would be a religious group, a union of churches in America, that would use the government, that would so control the government, to enforce Sunday worship. A look-alike of the papacy would be set up in America. This look-alike of Rome will use the state to enforce Sunday keeping on America. This image will persecute those who don't follow their Sunday tradition. Any idea who the image could be? Well, this is one of the major representatives of the image of the beast, Billy Graham. Apostate Protestant embrace the papal power, the beast, when they honor Sunday. By this act, they honor a man-made tradition and will suffer the horrific consequences. Billy Graham, of course, wrote the read the classic book, The Desire of Ages. You know, there's a lady down in Plant City, Florida, and she got my address and phone number, and she called me and she said, I want some of your books. So I sent her The Desire of Ages and Great Controversy. She read The Desire of Ages. You know what she called me on the phone? You know what she said? She started crying on the phone. She said, I love Jesus because I read this book when I saw what he did for me. She was crying, folks. She said, I want all the books you have by the person who wrote that book, Desire of Ages. Billy Graham read the book Desire of Ages. He said it was one of the best books he'd ever read on the life of Christ. When he came to the chapter on the Sabbath, Billy Graham declared, I can't keep the Sabbath. If I did, I'd lose all my popularity. I'd lose all my money from my supporters. So, friend, Billy Graham is a fitting example of apostate Protestantism that says, I hear what the Bible says, I hear what Ellen White says, but I'm going to do it my way. And that's scary, friends. That's scary. Revelation 15, 2-4 talks about a group of people who will stand through the final conflict that is just before us, friend. I saw as it were a sea of glass mingled with fire, and them that had gotten the victory over the beast, over the papal power and salvation in sin, over his image, apostate Protestantism, and over his mark of Sunday rebellion, and over the number of his name, 666, standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Who shall not fear thee, O Lord, and glorify thy name? For thou only art holy. For all nations shall come and worship before thee, for thy judgments are made manifest. Now, friend, that's the group we want to be in. They overcome the beast and his image and his mark and the number of his name. The proclamation of the first, second, and third angels' messages has been located by the word of inspiration. Not a peg or pin is to be removed. No human authority has any more right to change the location of these messages than to substitute the New Testament for the Old. The Old Testament is the gospel in figures and symbols. The New Testament is the substance. One is as essential as the other. This third angel's message, friend, is a life and death question. Nine manuscript release, page 290. We know that now everything is at stake. The third angel's message is to be at this time regarded as of the highest importance. It is a life and death question. The 18th chapter of Revelation reveals the importance of presenting the truth in no measured terms, but with boldness and power. There must be no toning down of the truth, no muffling of the message for this time. Satan has devised a state of things whereby the proclamation of the third angel's message shall be bound about. We must beware of his plans and methods. The third angel's message is to be strengthened and confirmed. Satan will so mingle his deceptions with truth that side issues will be created to turn the attention of the people from the great issue, the test to be brought upon the people of God in these last days. I wonder if Ellen White were alive today, what side issues she would say were turning the attention of God's people from the great issue, the test to be brought upon the people of God in these last days. Butchering of the spirit of prophecy. The third angel's message, Lenore, has been sounding since 1844, and it is to continue to sound till the close of probation. For somebody, Lenore, to say today that we are not to give the third angel's message till the Sunday law, Lenore, you need to give that person open heart surgery, and you will find that their heart is yellow. And then you need to give them back surgery and you will find that they have no spine. That's the problem, Lenore.
The proclamation is more loudly given after the Sunday roll, but it's still supposed to be given.
Absolutely. Lenore, by giving the message now, as people see the veracity of the three angels' messages, and they can see that time is hastening towards the exaltation of Rome, apostate Protestants, and Sunday worship, Lenore, that makes people just say, yes, I can trust the Word of God. So it strengthens people, Lenore, when they hear it now, to be ready for when it comes then. Well, the enforcement of the mark, Lenore, the mark of the beast is Sunday worship. The enforcement of that mark will, of course, bring persecution and trial, martyrdom for those that are faithful. But, Lenore, the mark of the beast, again, from 1844, when the three angels' messages began to be given because of the judgment hour message. That marks the time, Lenore, for those messages to be given. And they're to be given all the way from then till the close of probation. If they died, Lenore, and they knew about the Sabbath and they rejected it, they would die lost. Marcia, what's that?
William Miller rejected the Sabbath.
There's a big difference, Marcia, with William Miller. William Miller was mightily used by God. William Miller suffered probably worse than any other human being, a sorrow that no human being save the Lord Jesus Christ could understand. And of course, William Miller heard about the Sabbath, but close associates of his, Ellen White brings out, and I think it's in early writings, that some of his closest associates steered him away from the Sabbath. And so Ellen White says that angels of God guard his dust and he will come up at the end of time. So I think, Marcia, there's a real difference between William Miller and his experience versus, say, a Billy Graham. Okay? Billy Graham heard about the Sabbath, knew full well that the Sabbath was the seventh day of the week and should be honored. But Billy Graham, Marcia, weighed it very clearly and said, if I embrace the seventh day Sabbath, which is truth, then I will lose my following. Marcia, he chose worldly wealth, influence, and popularity above the truth of God. William Miller didn't do that. So there's a big difference. Big difference. First Selected Messages, page 372. Ellen White said, several have written to me inquiring if the message of justification by faith is the third angel's message. And I have answered, it is the third angel's message in verity. So friend, the third angel's message, the core of that message is that we will depend upon Christ and Him alone for forgiveness and power. That we will rely upon no man, no system for our salvation. So the third angel's message stringently warns against dependence upon man-made systems and people. Now, before we close, we have about 3 or 4 slides left. This is what's been going on amongst us as a people over the last many years in Seventh-day Adventism concerning the prophecies that we have just looked over this afternoon. William Johnson, the editor of the Adventist Review, back 21, 22 years ago, an insert in the Review and Herald called Saints Victory in the End of Time. He said this, to interpret the sea monster, the first beast of Revelation 13, as the papacy seems somewhat out of keeping with the spirit of the times. In an age when Christianity in general faces the onslaughts of secularism, and when among Christians ecumenism has become popular, the interpretation smacks of narrowness and bigotry. So according to William Johnson, what we've looked at this afternoon is narrow-minded bigotry. Shame on William Johnson, friend. This is pitiful. This is so pitiful. You know, if you go back and you look at every statement that Ellen White makes on the first beast of Revelation 13, she makes at least 75 different statements about that beast. Every time she says it's the papal power. So according to William Johnson, the spirit of prophecy is narrow-minded and a bigot. Oh, that's just sick. George Vandeman, in his book The Rise and Fall of Antichrist, not Christ, Antichrist, he said this, these were dark days for the church. How could Christians be so intolerant of their brothers and sisters in Christ? Jesus predicted that those who killed his followers would sincerely think they were serving God. It's not for us to question our medieval ancestors, nor must we overlook the good done by the church. Throughout the world, monasteries provided care for the orphans, widows, and the sick. And all of us owe appreciation to the church of the Middle Ages for preserving the scriptures. So according to George Vandeman, the Roman Catholic Church of the Dark Ages was the Christian church. They were called Christians. And the Catholic Church through the Dark Ages did some wonderful things. Monasteries, hospitals, and they preserved the Bible. Friend, those are just out-and-out lies. And what this tells me is, this is a great warning for us today, that if we don't stay humble in our own minds, if we don't walk with humility before Christ, then folk, we can come up with the most ridiculous statements and think that they're true. This is unbelievable. This is unbelievable. Myron Widmer in the Adventist Review in 1993, he wrote these words when John Paul came to Denver. He says, I was surprised and delighted to learn that the Bible is the sole textbook during the Pope's visit in the World Day Youth Activities. What a wonderful opportunity for so many young people to hear the gospel message straight from God's Word. John Paul II is now preaching the gospel. His own gospel. Unbelievable. Might a better understanding be that God is working through this Pope to open doors for Catholics to the great truths of Scripture concerning salvation by faith in Christ. So according to the Review back 25 years ago, John Paul II was preaching the great truths of Scripture in Denver. I can only wonder if in these last days God is using some very unexpected sources to encourage many individuals in their search for truth. You know what, folks? Myron Widmer, after he wrote this a few years later, I would like to tell you that Myron Widmer was let go of his job, but that's not true. Myron Widmer was allowed to go teach this garbage to Seventh-day Adventist young people at Pacific Union College in the Napa Valley. This is so disgusting. So disgusting. Ranko Stevanovic, professor of Andrews University, wrote a book called Revelation of Jesus Christ. It's over 600 pages. It's a commentary on the book of Revelation. The book is endorsed. I have a copy of it in my library back home. It is endorsed by Andrews and Notre Dame University. When commenting on the beast who comes up from the sea in Revelation 13, this scholar professor at Andrews University, he cannot clearly state who the beast is. He gets tongue-tied. Never once mentions the papal power. It's pathetic. And Samuel Bacciocchi, the Jesuit plant, Samuel Bacciocchi tells us this: the preceding analysis of the identifying marks of the prophetic Antichrist represented in Daniel 7 by the imagery of the little horn and in Revelation 13 by the symbol of a beast has shown that both the papacy and Islam fulfill the qualifying marks of this prophetic power. So what Samuel Bacciocchi is simply telling us is that the first beast of Revelation 13, it's the papacy, but it's also Islam. It's just sick, folks. It's sick. And God is calling a lowly people to simply hold on to the truths of His Word.
There was a guy on my spot that said that beast could be anybody, could be any nation could fit that description. And he was a Seventh-day Adventist.
You know, Lenore, any Seventh-day Adventist that chooses to walk away from the distinctive truths of the three angels' messages, the guy that you're referring to there, Lenore, if he continues down that path, he will end up in the lake of fire. That's where he'll end up. Because God has called us to identify the first beast of Revelation 13, to identify the beast and his image in Revelation 14. And if we forget those truths, Lenore, God will pass them by. He will pass them by and say, that's okay, you don't have to give the message, but I will find the weakest of the weak, and they will give the message. Great Controversy 439. Ellen White is so very, very clear. Over 90 times she identifies the papacy as the beast in Revelation 13, 1-10. Very, very clear, friend. It's not Islam. It's not Germany. It's not Russia. It's not China. It's not the European Union. It's the papacy. Well, God has a people, and He will always have a people that will declare the great truths of the book of Revelation. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word today. Thank you that it hasn't changed. Lord, we've seen some people that have chosen to step away from proclaiming your truths. They've become casualties. In any war, though, Lord, there are casualties. Thank you so much. There can be another million more casualties. There can be 100 million casualties. But your truth will go marching on. Your truth will win. And those who will walk in humble obedience to your words will win with it. Father in heaven, save us. Please save us from our greatest enemy, ourselves. Save us from pride. Save us from self-sufficiency. Save us from our wisdom. And help us to cling to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. In his name.